Well, that slagged us off, and you thought we were down and out. We came back scrapping just to show what we're all about.
Well, Calum, it's finally here. Euro 2020 2021 kicks off today, and it's a special red tinted glasses, or should we say tartan tinted glasses, episode today as we preview Scotland's hopes for the first major tournament in 23 years. And, you know, we should say thanks to Scott McGill. It was Scott And The Eejits there with the intro song, Whatever It Takes. Make sure you check them out on Spotify and YouTube. And let's see whatever it takes to get this podcast out. And I'm sure we can piece together our hopes for the tournament ahead. But, you know, it's been a 23-year wait. Both of us, Calum, won't have remembered. Well, I certainly won't. And if I don't, you definitely won't remember the last time we were at a major tournament. How do you feel ahead of Monday's big kickoff? You know, we're 3 days away from Scotland's first game.
I was a mere twinkle in my father's eye last time Scotland played at a tournament. I am absolutely buzzing. Not obviously, for a lot of people well, our age, nobody knows what it feels like. And I feel, I'm so excited. Like, I can't contain myself, essentially. And I'm getting weirdly optimistic. I can understand why the English get optimistic and get excited every time. I think stupidly optimistic, but I honestly don't care at this stage. I'm just happy, just delighted. What are you? How are you feeling?
Yeah, I'm all aboard the hype train. You know, for those of you that have maybe been listening to various podcasts out there, the Tartan Scarf has done a brilliant preview of Monday's game, and he will be, Gordon is previewing each and every game. So if you want an up-to-date preview of the games, make sure you check out at the Tartan Scarf on Spotify and Twitter. But, you know, I listened to that preview today and, oh, it really didn't help my optimism. It's just, you know, my confidence for Monday is going through the roof. And I really, you know, Andy from Hamden Roar podcast said, you know, you kind of got to rein that in. There's just got to be that bit of caution, because we all know it's going to be the hope that kills us at the end of the day. But yeah, I think we're definitely all riding the crest of this optimistic wave.
I think so. I think you've got to just enjoy it. And we could get papped out of the group stage, could not win a game, could not score a goal. But the fact we're even involved, to be honest, for once, is it's something to behold. I think that the country will be well behind the team, and no matter what happens, but there is that little bit of optimism that is, it's lingering. I think we've just got to buy into it, to be honest.
I think if you're not buying into it, you're either a Rangers fan or you've got no interest in football.
Yep, that'll go down well if anyone find it. Glen, nice one.
No, I will say tongue in cheek there, but you know, have you been watching any of the programmes on the BBC Scotland channel or STV this week?
I've actually not. So that's not going to help this podcast at all, me saying that, if you've got something prepared for that. But I've got them recorded. There's a few things on Friday night that I've eyed up that I've got recorded. Looking forward to it. I think there's something on right now as we speak, actually, a sports scene thing or something.
Yeah, there's a, as we're recording this on Thursday night, it's away with the Tartan Army, people going down memory lane of their trips away. So I've got that one on record and looking forward to that. But, you know, Mr. Brown's Boys was on last night or a couple of nights ago, you know, detailing France 98 and the players' memories. And honestly, like, what a buzz that must have been, you know, seeing us score against Brazil, equalising against Brazil. Okay, we didn't get out of the group stage, you know, we've yet to do that at a major tournament, but what that must have been like. Okay, you know, probably living in an age where there wasn't the smartphone, so most of their memories will have been photos or just ingrained into your brain, and it's just like, oh, it just looks fantastic. And it is a bit of a shame, you know, this championship's obviously in, you know, kind of setting up a pandemic, and not everyone's going to get to games. You know, myself and you are actually fortunate enough to get a ticket for a game. We're going to come on to that in a second. But I think regardless of if you're able to go to a game or not going to get to a game, people will get swept up in the hype and hysteria that surrounds a tournament. You know, I was listening to Greg James on Radio 1 this morning. He hates football, but he says he can't help but get involved with this big tournament hype that's sweeping through the nation.
Yeah, I feel like it does have that sort of effect. International football for many is like the worst part of the regular season. But then when it comes to a tournament, it gets people who aren't even interested in football involved. And I'm fully buying into the excitement. Some of the little videos that like sort of BBC and Sky have been putting out as well, really building up my hopes, expectations, building up my excitement. And yeah, you mentioned it. Somehow blagged my way into getting a ticket. Total, I have no idea how that's happened.
Yeah, and I suppose then, you know, we were speaking before recording when you said you'd got a ticket. For someone that's been to a few Scotland games, and obviously like we've said, you know, didn't appreciate the last time we were at a major tournament, and who knows when we'll get there again. What's that feeling like for you, knowing that you'll be at the first game against Czech Republic on Monday?
Basically, I'll give a little bit of backstory. It was a friend's friend who's from the Czech Republic. One of his friends had tickets. I think he's in the Czech Republic and couldn't make it. So now we've ended up with his tickets. Basically, we got offered them, and it was like, I'm thinking, once in a lifetime opportunity. First of all, I've not been to a football game in ages, let alone Scotland. I haven't even played at a major tournament in 23 years. So it's just, I think it had to be done, but I'm so excited. It's genuinely immeasurable, not even just because it's a football game, but obviously because it's Scotland, it's even bigger. I don't know. I think I'll be a nervous wreck come kickoff. I don't know. I really am struggling to put it into words. It's just going to be mayhem, I feel like. I think that's the only way I'm going to describe it.
Yeah, I think, well, for both of us, the last game the wheel of being in a football stadium for would have been Aberdeen against Hibs in March. And, you know, it feels surreal that we've waited, 15 months, 16 months maybe, and the next time that we'll both be watching a live game of football, we'll be seeing Scotland in a major tournament. You know, my first game following Scotland was a 1-1 draw against Germany 18 years ago. I've seen us play Belarus. I've been abroad to Belgium, Gibraltar, although that was played in the Algarve. I've done Ireland, Slovakia, Wembley. I've put in the miles with the Tartan Army. I've been down there on a Monday night, a Thursday night, you know, bus back and then into work after just a few hours sleep. For those that have followed the team through thick and thin and maybe been following them since 98 and probably can't believe it's been this long, I feel that it's, you know, kind of justification for all the dedication that many of these fans put. Like what you said, you know, international football is only enjoyable, maybe it seems, for a select few, but hopefully with the team Steve Clark's building and the momentum of this tournament, more and more people can get back to Hampden and get behind the national team.
I think, yeah, definitely sort of people my age, I'm a little bit younger than you, Glenn. I think I've possibly suffered from not being a tournament for so long. Maybe the interest isn't there so much for us. I do feel like a little bit of a fraud. You listening out all those games, that's how you've qualified for a ticket for Wembley, maybe, Ad. And then I've just got off a friend of a friend.
To be fair, I was offered a ticket from a friend, a ticket for the opening game, but after spending £108 for a ticket for Wembley, it was going to be another £108, but I took the decision, look, I'm going to get a chance to at least see them. And I did say to Sean that if I didn't get a ticket for Wembley, I'd have definitely taken that ticket for the Czech Republic. You know, fair enough, there's a lot of guys that are going to go to all three games, but I don't really know how much I could have justified that that expense, especially if, you know, we get out of the group stage. I'm saving money for the rounds after, hopefully.
There goes that optimism again, yeah. But I think even to be able to take in one, given the limited numbers, is, well, the tickets like gold dust, essentially. And after so long, they would have been like gold dust anyway, even if we qualified in normal circumstances and the tournament was played under normal circumstances, let alone now.
Yeah, and I think that's the disappointing thing for, you know, myself and many other supporters club members that are probably on like 11 points and above that missed out for Hampden through loyalty points and didn't get out of the supporters club allocation. You know, I backed off not going for them in the ballot in the hope that the situation in this pandemic would have improved by now. You know, maybe some people think that that's a stupid idea, but hey, you've got to remain optimistic. That's going to be the word of the show, I feel. I think so. It is what it is. Just now, I'm unfortunate enough to have an entry time 3 hours before kickoff for Wembley. But at the end of the day, I'm going to be there. You know, you're maybe fortunate. Was it an hour before you've got?
So we've managed to get three tickets between us, and I've drawn the short straw, and I'm by myself. So because it was two tickets together, one by himself in like the next block, and not only that, but I'm also in an hour early, so I'm in at 11:30. Yeah. It's not great at all, but
no,
I'm there. I probably won't care at the time, let's be honest. So,
and as someone said, just take a charge bank for your phone, sit on your phone, and by the time the warm-up comes, you'll probably get swept up in the build-up of the occasion. But you know, as Scotland fans, you know, we were both set to go to the Israel playoff semi-final. Unfortunately, that ended up being behind closed doors. What's your hopes for Scotland in this tournament? Are you confident that we will get out the group stage, or is this just the wave of optimism that's sweeping the nation that feels like that? Or do you genuinely believe that we've got enough in the squad?
I think had it been just the top two teams of every group, then we probably would have stood little to no chance. Maybe some chance. But given the fact, was it four of the six third place teams go through?
Mm-hmm.
That's possible, because there will probably be at least one team that goes through with just like 3 points.
Yeah.
That's very possible, depending on goal difference, obviously. I think we could maybe nip through. If we could get through into a knockout game, success for me. That's a major success given how long it's been. And I am hopeful of that. I think if we can start off with a win against the Czech Republic, I mean, I'm saying that as if it's guaranteed. It's no mean feat. Is that right?
That's a saying.
Oh God, it's been a while.
I know.
What was I saying? Yeah, I think we could win against Czech Republic, and that'd be a good way to start off with the group. And then maybe if we could somehow sneak a point in one of the other two games, then we're probably just about guaranteed. Well, how are you feeling? Are you same or a bit more cautious?
I've said I think the aim should be 4 points. You know, look to get the, you know, I was listening to John Bleasdale, who's does a fantastic podcast with the Scottish Football Forum, and he's done some brilliant podcasts with Sam Matterface, Rory Hamilton, and our good friend from Sky Sports, Charles Patterson, also joined him as part of a Bonanza preview podcast on Scotland's chances. So again, if you're looking for some more Euro 2020 previews at this weekend before Monday, make sure you check John's podcast out. And, you know, he was speaking about the England game being a free hit. Mm-hmm. Now, I agree with that to an extent. However, I only see that as being a free hit if we avoid defeat to the Czech Republic. So if we draw or beat the Czechs, I would probably say, yeah, the England game's a free hit. And it'll, as John said, take care of itself. And whatever comes, comes, because, you know, it's a derby game, and derby games are pretty unpredictable. But you've got to be looking at two home games in a major tournament. Let's be honest, are there going to be many away fans there? It should be a pretty solid home backing. I'd like to think we can take advantage of that. So I'd be targeting, you know, the Croats have never beaten us in international football, so hopefully that's a good omen. We beat the Czechs twice in the Nation League, albeit the first time was a weakened squad. Why not? Let's take that confidence. The game against the Netherlands in the warm-ups, that gave me a lot of confidence, because we played the occasion instead of playing the opponent. You know, we kind of didn't play with much fear. Took the game to the Netherlands in large spells. And, you know, albeit for a soft free kick, we would have won that game.
Yeah, I would say so. But when you said it was free hit, I think it's free hit not only if we avoid defeat against the Czechs, I think if we beat the Czechs, because even if we get 1 point...
But that's what I'm saying, maybe the Gordon's education let me down there, but I meant a free hit is we avoid defeat, so as long as we don't lose the opening game, Wembley becomes a free hit.
I would say we'd have to probably win for that to be the case, because then otherwise you've then got to go and beat Croatia, who... pretty good on the international stage. Okay, they've not beat us, but in recent years they've done pretty well. Then we've got to go and play them, and we know what they're capable of.
It's, you know, it's a fair point. It's like, it's good that we don't agree on these things, and other people have their own opinions, because some people will say, why should we be going down to Wembley with the view that it's a free hit? Let's go down and, as you said before we started recording, let's get Declan Gallagher to score a hat-trick of headers.
Mm-hmm. I think, honestly, anything could happen at Wembley, because I feel like, as is probably always the case, they're probably going to walk in there with that sort of arrogance of, we're England, we should be smashing Scotland, da 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 da.
And if the players don't, the fans certainly will.
Exactly. And that might Michael Cross. Southgate, I don't trust that. I wouldn't trust that man as far as I could throw him, to be honest. He's a bit of a passion merchant.
And actually, from the podcast that I was listening to that John had done in his Euro Bonanza, it was actually a Kilmarnock fan was on there. And he said, you know, if you kind of look at the England game, is Steve Clarke had an excellent record against Celtic and Rangers. What's not to say he's got a game plan already? He frustrated Rangers so often, especially at Rugby Park, and did well against Celtic as well. If he's got a game plan to frustrate, we just need that one chance. Take that chance on, like, you know, hopefully our finishing's better than it was against Luxembourg. And who knows? Defend properly, defend well, take your chances. And as you said, anything can happen.
And one thing that also gives me confidence going into these games is actually a man that I've been quite critical of, Andy Robertson. In the two friendlies, I think he's upped his game. I don't think I've seen him play like that for Scotland in quite a while, if ever, maybe.
Yeah, I think him and Kieran Tierney started proving a lot of doubters wrong in these last two games.
Yeah, 100%.
Their link-up play has been great, overlapping, covering for each other. Encouraging. Shea Adams coming in scoring, encouraging. You know, even Jack Hendry, we don't know where that came from, but you know, Steve Clarke's got selection headaches ahead of Monday night.
You're fucking space cadet. Some boy. I hope he does something just so I can use that. Yeah, no, he does, and that's a great problem to have. Right back, another one. I presume he will start his son, Stephen O'Donnell. But at the same
I was gonna say. So let's look at kind of those problem areas. Who do you start at right back on Monday?
I think Patterson came in and did well against Luxembourg when he came on. He looks pretty good going forward. But at an international tournament, our first game in at the Euros, international tournament in 23 years. It's a different kind of pressure situation, which he has dealt with pressure situations playing for Rangers, obviously in the Europa League, I think against Celtic as well at times. Yeah. But I would go with I'd probably go with Stephen O'Donnell. I'm not his biggest fan. He's not particularly great going forward, but I think he's reliable enough. He's sturdy, maybe is the word I'd use.
Yeah, I'll hold my hands up and say, you know, I wasn't sure on the call-up of Nathan Patterson, you know, given his relative inexperience. Well, certainly his inexperience on the international stage. Yeah, and, you know, he's not played often for Rangers this season, but I could certainly see the hype around him, you know, from his performance against Luxembourg. And I think, you know, we didn't really defend well, especially set pieces against Luxembourg. I thought Jack Hendry and Liam Cooper did well against the Dutch. You know, Grant Hanley did well against Austria when he came back into the squad. So I'll be interested to see what Steve Clarke does. I wouldn't be too disappointed if he just went with the same back two that he started against the Netherlands.
This is going to sound totally ridiculous, but given the level we're at, I'm quite happy with our centre-back's choice compared to England's. Okay, they've got Harry Maguire and John Stones, but then the gap between...
If Harry Maguire's even fit, though.
The gap between those two, then down to Tyrone Mings and Connor Cody, it's quite big. But it will be interesting. And centre mid's another big problem area. Billy Gilmour came in, did very, very well before getting whacked, and hopefully he's okay as well. I'm excited to see what happens, to be honest.
And let's say... Let's go for what you would do then. Do you start Callum McGregor, go for that experienced player that's played, well, countless games? I think it was over 200 games he's played in the last 2 years or something like that. You know, Steve Clarke knows what he can do. Like you've said, you know, he's playing his son, Stephen O'Donnell, right back. Does he play his second son, Callum McGregor, in the middle, or do you go for Billy Gilmore?
I think against Czech Republic, I would like to see Billy Gilmore, because that's a team where, that's a game where we might have a bit more control of the game kind of thing. And Billy Gilmore is a bit more creative, I would say, probably, than Callum McGregor. Less of a hatchet man, maybe. But then I can definitely see him coming in to play at Wembley, because he will give a bit more discipline in middle of the park, a bit more experience, and that'd be vital then. But I would love to see McGinn, McTominay, Gilmore when we play against Czech Republic.
Yeah, I mean, I think so would I. I'll say that, you know, Callum McGregor's not been a player that I've been impressed with on at national level. I think he flatters to deceive, but you know, especially when you look at how Ryan Jack's come into the side and kind of goes about his business quietly and has become quite an important player for the national team. So I'd like to see what Billy Gilmore can do. And I kind of tend to agree with the points you've made, but I'm glad it's not us that's got to make this choice. But, you know, one thing I suppose is that there's going to be five subs during the tournament. So even if he doesn't start, I would expect him to get some game time on Monday. I'd be very surprised if he doesn't, because we saw like kind of the influence he had in that short cameo. I think it was 20 minutes or something against Luxembourg. And, you know, good save from the keeper to not deny him a goal as well. So, you know, he can't offer a lot, and that was just 20 minutes, let alone giving him a decent spell.
Definitely showed very quick feet in that run as well. Yeah, I think it'll be interesting. To be honest, I wasn't even aware it was five substitutes. Thought it was maybe still three. Who knows? I'm glad you're paying attention. That's actually been a theme for this whole podcast. Really,
yeah, you can tell who's listened to plenty of preview podcasts as well, because that's where I got that information from.
I've just been blaring the tunes instead. Yeah. Blaring whatever it takes. And I had the Proclaimers just on constant loop today. If Michael's tuning in, he'll enjoy that. Good Hibs, mate.
Yeah, I'm sure he will be tuning in. And up top, you know, we saw in the game against Luxembourg, Lyndon Dykes and Che Adams linking up for the goal, and then also linking up for the red card. Stupidest red card you'll see in an international friendly. Would you be inclined to go two up front against the Czechs, or put another man in midfield and go one up top? You know, maybe Ryan Christie might come in and play off one of Dykes and Che Adams.
I think you've got to go two up top. You've got to go for it. It's our opening game of the tournament. It's our most winnable game. Yeah, and it's at home. So I think he's got to go for it. And they've showed good partnerships. And to be fair, Che Adams can also play slightly off Dykes as well. Not quite as an out-and-out striker. So that's another option. They'll link up. Yeah, they'll link up. Plays look decent. I think there's a clear gulf in class in the two of them, I think. Yes, probably fair to say. Nothing against Lyndon Dykes, but you can tell he's a championship striker, and Che Adams is Premier League quality. But I'd go with them both, and they're two very, very different players. They offer a lot of different sort of attributes in the game.
Yeah.
So I'd be tempted to go with them both. Certainly against Czech Republic, see if we can get that win, and then that takes a little bit of pressure off in the other two.
Totally. I mean, other than playing the Scotland tunes, maybe some of you have created Scotland playlists. Hopefully, like we've said, whatever it takes is in there. I've pretty much listened to it every day for the last 2 weeks. So a really good song to get you in the mood. The way the bagpipes and the footsteps in the intro. I've really enjoyed what Scott's done with that song. Let's end the podcast then. Let's continue the hype and optimism, hopefully, with your answers here. Do we qualify from the group, and which player will be our standout / star performer, do you reckon?
Yes, we qualify from the group. Probably as one of the best third place teams, I would think. And my standout performer, Declan Gallagher, obviously, after the hat trick of headers at Wembley. I would probably say Che Adams, because I think sometimes perhaps we struggle to score some goals, and he's the man that I think will come up with a couple of big ones. I mean, John McGinn's obviously up there as well. He's obviously up there. good old meatball. But I think Shea Adams will chip in with the vital goals. It'll be a big tournament for Shea Adams. What about you? What are you thinking? Are we qualifying?
Oh yeah, we're qualifying without a doubt. I'm fully on that hype train. Get us to the knockout stages. The squad seems to have that confidence about them, well, quiet confidence maybe. And I think, you know, I was listening to John McGinn saying, you know, we're going into this tournament with no pressure on us. And I think that's going to work for Scotland. You know, the only expectations coming off our own fans.
That's,
you know,
true.
The media are kind of maybe cautiously optimistic, but it's not like what the English media are like. Mm. Or English fans anyway. Mm. So yeah, I think we'll have enough about us. Let's just hope we get off to the right start on Monday. Interesting choice that you went for the star man. I've got him in my fantasy Euro 2020 team, so hopefully that's right. I was going to say John McGinn, which I feel is a bit of a cop out. I think given that the tournament, like obviously with where he is at Villa just now, if he can kick on, you know, he's been such a vital player to us.
Mm-hmm.
Goals, assists. He seems to be the heart of everything good about the national team just now. And I think this tournament could really be the stepping stone for the next stage in his career. Possibly, you know, if he does stand out, Villa could have a job on their hands keeping him this summer.
It's very possible. I suppose you could equally say maybe Shea Adams. But I think John McGinn's been the standout performer in getting us there, really, let's be honest. And he probably will kick on and take it on to that next level. I hope so. It seems like a laugh as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, so the talking is done. The action's nearly underway for us, Calum.
Mm-hmm.
Let's hope. Whatever it takes.
Exactly. We'll do it. 100%. If you're tuning in on YouTube, don't forget to subscribe and like the video. Comment down below with your thoughts as well on who will your star man be. Look at this, getting an interaction. And if you're listening on Spotify or anywhere else, be sure to follow us and on Twitter at @RTG_podcast. And I'll leave the links to Scott's song and things down below too. And it's actually, he's raising all profits for a very, very good cause as well.
Yeah. And make sure to check out Scott and the Eejits. Whatever it takes, if you are listening on Spotify, make sure to download it, add it to that playlist. Get in the spirit. Come on, Scotland. Oh, Scotland. Well, one in the same.